Well, it's really an honor to be here in so many ways. And I think of today as being maybe a data blitz or maybe speed data-ing, you know? So I think it's the right way to do this occasion. And in case some of you don't understand the subtitle here, I just thought you should know that this is a tribute talk, but actually not to Barbra Streisand, to Dan Wegner. And so this may become less and less apparent the more I talk, but he really has a lot to do with the ideas that I'm going to be talking about here. We had a telephone conversation, one of our first, probably the first telephone conversation in, I don't know, the 80s sometime, and he called up and he said, I'd like to do an NAGSHEAD conference on control, but not that old-fashioned, boring kind of control, the newfangled kind of control, and, you know, I think we should organize this. And I thought, newfangled, invite, put those in one word, in one sentence, that sounds pretty good to me. I'm not sure I ever quite got the newfangled part, you did, but it made me realize that I was working on issues of control, so that was a good thing. So thank you for inspiring, you know, so many ideas in the field. I'll stop there, but you know. I also want to thank Dan Gilbert for, you know, organizing this and being, you know, a true friend to the field and a true friend to your Dan friend. So, and finally, I want to thank another Dan, so a perfect trifecta of Dans here, Dan Ames, whose data I'm going to be talking about here today. So, what I want to talk about, and this is another part that I think is relevant to some of the things that you've thought, which is that people use their mental processes for social reasons. That's why we think, you know. In my case, mind perception is going to be related to dispositional attributions and forming impressions and so on. But we like to quote William James because his hall is not too far away from here. Thinking for doing, but it's really social thinking is for social doing. So here's the Barbra Streisand part. I'll resist singing it. But the bottom line is that when people need each other, they pay more attention and they think harder about each other. So what we knew back when Dan called me up about this conference, what we knew at that point is that people who need other people pay attention to them, hello, makes sense, and they also infer things about their minds. And Ralph Erber in this fuzzy picture was the person I worked with on this, who later went on to work with Dan as well. But what's been bugging me ever since then was, but are they really forming impressions? You know, we knew they were making dispositional inferences, but is that the same thing as forming an impression? Is it a holistic picture of a person or not? What is it anyway? And so that little thing in the back of my mind never got taken care of. So now we're going to fast forward to the 21st century, where we have other ways of thinking about whether people are forming impressions or not, namely looking at the medial prefrontal cortex. This is one of the most reliable findings in social neuroscience. You don't even, I mean, we have this, you know, a couple of meta-analyses sitting over there, one of them, a living, breathing meta-analysis. That's what you are, Jason. But it's really wonderful for social psychologists, because this really is about thinking for social doing. It so reliably comes online when people think about other people. So we decided to harness this newfangled, finally I got the newfangled part, by looking at whether when people need other people, when they're outcome dependent, not only do they pay attention to them, especially their more surprising aspects, and make dispositional attributions, but are they doing individual mind perceiving impressions? So it's a form of converging evidence for the kind of thing that we have found before. Basically, I wanted to know, were we making it up before, or is there some other kind of evidence for this? So we're harnessing the MPFC to index impression formation. And the thing that's really crucial here is that Dan Ames and I decided we needed to do it in a really real and involving setting. because otherwise it's not impression formation. Otherwise it's simulation, you know, which is important. But we wanted people to really meet somebody, think about them, care about what happened. And you put that in the same method section with a scanner, uh-oh. So this was the real challenge. So to get the big picture, the design here is they're outcome dependent on somebody and they're not outcome dependent on somebody else. That is, they can win a prize with one person and not with the other. And they're gonna see information about both people that fits their expectation and other information that doesn't fit their expectation. So they've got this, it's like life, you know, you meet somebody, you know some things about them, you care more, you know, at the coffee break, there's some people you know, are more contingent on than others. You expect things about certain people, and then you get this mishmash of information coming at you. Well, our prediction is that when you're not outcome dependent, it's easier just to go through the coffee break and say, check, check, check. I knew that about that person. I knew that about that person. Yes, right, just what I thought. But if you need the person for something and they do something weird, then you go, oh, I have to make sense of that. Okay. And you think about it. So simple design, complicated procedure. People come into the lab. Here's Dan Ames, busy, looking like a neuroscientist, right? And look at those little wind-up toys. That makes it look like more fun than usual. So what they're going to be doing with these wind-up toys is looking at how experts and non-experts work together to solve creative problems. That is, designing educational games for children. So the Princeton undergraduates meet two Confederates who they are told come from Rutgers. So they, but they're education majors, so they have the expertise to do this kind of thing. One of them, we tell them we're looking at, you know, the structure of the relationship. So one of them, a prize, a $50 prize, depends on their work together. They're outcome dependent on one of the people and not outcome dependent on the other. They're going to meet her and work. They already met her and they're going to work with her, but they're not outcome dependent on her. It's counterbalanced. Different person is the outcome dependent person. One's not. The other one's not. So the first thing we do is we bring them into the lab where they meet these two Confederates. And notice that there are two experimenters, the little green dots on the left. The purpose of the second experimenter, the person with the clipboard, that's the white square there, is to watch what the subject, who is the orange dot in the middle, does in terms of looking. So the first thing we found out, which you would expect, is as an ecological measure of attention, they look more at the person on whom they're outcome dependent. As soon as he explained the contingencies, you guys can win $50 together, you guys are gonna work together, but it's, you know, your independent contribution, they start exchanging glances with the person who they need. So, you know, we can say that the manipulation took. And then they find out, you know, who they're paired up with and how well they're going to do. So one of them says, I might be pretty good at this, and the other one says, well, you know, it's not really my strongest suit. Ruh-roh. And then, in addition to this written expectation, they brought a USB key with their teaching evaluations on it, which Dan plugs into the computer, things rumble and roar and so on, and then they go into the scanner where they will see some information that's consistent with the expectancy, whether positive or negative. And the same information is inconsistent with the other expectancy. So everything's all counterbalanced to heck and everything's fine that way. But as an experience for a subject, it's very much like being in real life. When they go into the scanner, they see, here's one person, that's the person they're outcome dependent on, who's expected to do well, this fits, okay, that's fine. Then they see another piece of information about the other person, well, okay, that fits. They weren't expecting her to do so well. And then they get another piece, and they get another piece. So they get all this information online as you would get it at the coffee hour, and everything's all counterbalanced, so it's not the same person they're outcome dependent on, a positive, negative, and everything, the pictures and everything like that. Okay, so the results, bingo. Remember, the design's a simple social psychologists, 2x2, outcome dependent or not, consistent or inconsistent information. We're predicting MPFC activation, 2. When they're not outcome dependent, the consistent information. That's the check, check, check. I knew this. It's what I expected. It's fine. But when they need the person, they can't afford to do that. They really need, if they're going to do well and get the $50 prize, they have to pay attention to the things that are surprising. So under outcome dependency, it's the inconsistent information they should be forming impressions about. We identified an area of the MPFC with an independent localizer task. For those of you for whom that means something, you'll appreciate why we did that. For those who don't, forget it. We'll just say it's objective. And there's the kicker, which is that on the left-hand side, under not outcome dependent, they in fact activate the MPFC more to the consistent information than they do under when they're outcome dependent, and the reverse. They prioritize inconsistent information in the MPFC when they are in fact outcome dependent. You have no idea how long this slide took to generate. Months of data analysis, that one little graph. So just look at it a moment. And appreciate Dan Ames. And the other Dans. So thank you very much.